As the world warms and sea levels rise, coastlines around the world are at risk of being overwhelmed. Human infrastructure, such as ports and cities, can be protected from coastal flooding by seawalls and other engineering solutions. But these may not be suitable for natural coastal habitats, such as intertidal mudflats or mangroves, as these are sustained by the ebb and flow of the tides. So how can these wild spaces be protected from the rising seas? From Singapore to the United Kingdom, efforts are ongoing to ensure that coastal wildlife can continue to thrive, using a mix of engineering and nature-based solutions.
This is Wallasey Island, located along the southeastern coast of England. This island was once covered with farmlands, but efforts are now underway to progressively create a series of coastal wetland habitats here. This will not only protect against future sea level rise, it also benefits a variety of wildlife, such as seals and water birds.
So the RSPB wanted to create some wetland habitat to replace some of the lost habitats that are happening through because of sea level rise and coastal squeeze. Wallasey Island was looked at as one of those because it was actually at risk of its seawalls breaking anyway, which would have been devastating to the area. So it was a good opportunity to maybe combine those two aims to a project to restore the habitat and make some new seawall to replace some of that that was looking fragile.
When sea levels rise, natural habitats like wetlands or marshes usually respond by migrating landward. But seawalls or other human infrastructure can block their landward crawl, causing the natural habitat to shrink. This is known as the coastal squeeze. In England, the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds is working to overcome this by raising land levels on Wallasey Island using soil from a tunnelling project in London.
The RSPB partnered up with Crossrail, which is a big railway project through London, and they were creating lots of tunnels for the new railway. And that material through the tunnelling actually came to Wallasey Island by ship and was deposited in this area around us here. And it raised the land and we could create the different habitats we needed to maximise its usefulness for wildlife and its benefits. So we created a whole range of heights of land for the different habitats, ranging from upper salt marsh all the way down to mudflat. And then after that was done, Crossrail actually broke through the old seawall and through the breach behind us, where the water could come in from the rivers on each tide and fill the area to make it a tidal wetland.
And because we were able to raise land levels, we could design it with different land levels and lagoons and islands to make the area more interesting and sort of mimic natural habitats that would have existed before the area was reclaimed from the sea. So if you look across, you can see mudflats in the lower lying areas, which have lots of food in, lots of ragworms and shells that wading birds, particularly those species that breed a lot further north in the Arctic, they come here in winter, so it's crucial feeding habitat for them. And then the brown areas are plants called glasswort and annual sea blight, which colonise the lower areas. They produce lots of seed, they're annual plants, and a lot of wildfowl eat those seeds. And then you can see a sort of transition as it gets higher, as you go through different vegetation zones. The seed doesn't sort of really quite come up to those areas, those bits that are above the highest tides. So we get this nice transition.
In Singapore, the National Parks Board is also working to protect natural habitat at Kranji Coastal Nature Park from coastal erosion. This had made it difficult for mangroves, which are natural solutions to guard an area against sea level rise, to thrive.
So the interesting thing is that if you just look back 5 to 6 years, where I'm standing now used to be water, right? So between where that tree is that you see leaning and the landward side, it used to be water. So there used to be water on the outside, and then it swung back in, and there was a channel which is circular over here. So what happens is that there is a lot of energy which first of all was washing away the landward side, such that there is a red cliff. And at the same time, if you look at this tree, it was scouring the sediment on which the tree was perched. So you see the tree starting to lean. So what happened is we found out that there was too much energy. This strip of big trees that you see that used to be here were being undermined. So they were in danger of basically falling in, having all their substrate, their sediment, their soil, their organic matter being washed out from under them and falling into the water.
NParks installed a rock revetment wall in between the mangrove habitat and the coastal forest located farther inland. The wall helped to slow down wave energy, promoting sediment accretion and natural mangrove regeneration.
We put up that rock revetment, gentle grading, lots of space for plants to establish. And you can see that since 2019, when we finished the construction of this area, a very nice gentle succession has come in. You can see the Evisceneas come in, and the first ones that established themselves, you can see right now they are more than 2 meters tall already. And what has happened is that the Evisceneas have come in and their little pencil roots have helped to hold in sediment. So first thing that has happened is after we have done this intervention of blocking the channel, putting up this rock revetment, is that the energy has been abated. That has resulted in a calmer situation, less energy. So that allowed for reaccretion of sediments, organic matter. And then that has allowed for Evisceneia to come in. They have re-established themselves in between the rock revetments, and because of their prop roots growing, they have also helped in accreting a lot of sediments. So when the high tide comes in, it brings in some of these fine sediments, and when the tide goes out, these fine sediments are trapped in by their roots. So this whole area here, the mud that you see, the sand that you see, all these things have been accreted over these few years, just a few short years of, first of all, the wave energy being stopped, and at the same time, these plants holding on to the sediments that come in during the tides. And it's really cool to see, in just a few short years, you can get the first wave and the second wave of what will eventually become a big mangrove forest establishing itself.
Mangrove habitats are considered a nature-based solution because of the ability of their roots to trap sediment, helping them keep pace with sea level rise. NParks' intervention at Kranji Coastal Nature Park has also been beneficial for wildlife.
The other thing that has happened is because of all that circular current energy that has stopped, there's this pit that you can see. It used to be fairly narrow because all this action and all this energy was taking away all the sediments. Now the action and energy has stopped, it is slowly starting to accrete. And what we are seeing is basically young birds that are flying in again during the migratory season from the East Asian Australasian Flyway. They are sitting and sleeping inside Sungai Buloh Wetland Reserve. And then when it's low tide, they come down here to this pit and they feed. And they feed very well simply because of the organic matter that has started to accrete here lends itself to invertebrates coming back and repopulating the area. You can see some vestiges here. You can see the little snails that are coming in. And together with the snails, you get worms that establish themselves in the sediments. And that provides a rich source of feeding material, of protein, food for all these migratory waders.